Okay, we are back. I'm very happy to have on the Goldstein on Geld show Dr. Jeff Cornwall, who's a professor of entrepreneurship. Jeff, a real pleasure to have you.
Thank you. I'm glad to be with you.
So it's kind of a unique professorship these days, certainly compared to the time when I was in school. Can you tell us a little bit about what got you started in the world of academic entrepreneurship?
Sure, I'd be happy to. Actually, I grew up in the world of entrepreneurship, and I was one of those people who had small business and family business at the supper table every night, and so it was kind of in my blood. Years back in the early 1980s, I got into academics really because it was a bad job market, and I needed to make a living, and there was a teaching job open, so I started teaching.
All right.
And I was teaching corporate kind of stuff and really wanted to teach small business and entrepreneurship, but at that time business schools had no interest in it. Mm-hmm. And so taught for a few years and then left academics and went back into the private sector and started several healthcare companies and never really looked back, never thought I'd get back into it. But after we sold our company, decided it might be fun to look at an academic career again later in life, and lo and behold, entrepreneurship had become pretty well entrenched, at least here in the United States, in the university market. So there was lots of really interesting opportunities.
So when you say the business schools weren't interested in it, is that because there weren't as many small businesses or upstarts, or simply because no one realized this was a study in and of itself?
Well, I think the reality is we have to look at who funded the business schools. And if you look at all the sort of bellwether business schools in not only the U.S. but really around the globe, most of them were funded by corporate America, and they were looking to have a place where managers could be professionally trained and get a university education, and that was sort of the genesis of business education. So it was always viewed as sort of a management corporate kind of a degree. I almost dropped out of college because my professors encouraged me to do so, not because I was a bad student, which I wasn't, but because they're going, why in the world do you want to study business when you're going to go into the family business and small business environment? So there's a real disconnect for a long time because business schools were created by and for really the corporate world.
Okay, so let's talk about the smaller entrepreneur, which my guess is more of the type of audience we have here on the Goldstein on Geld show. So.
Right.
There's obviously a real risk that anyone has starting up his own business, and certainly in a difficult economy, you would think that people would be particularly afraid. How has the troubled economy really affected entrepreneurs these days?
Well, I think what I have found is the entrepreneurs who are better prepared and more savvy and certainly the ones that we train in university settings, but even the ones who are self-trained and well-educated on their own are doing better. If we go back to the early 2000s when everything was booming, it was pretty easy to have some success of one sort or another. And what's happened is while the economy has made it more difficult for some, I think the ones who are better prepared are actually doing quite well right now.
Okay, and when you talk about an entrepreneur, maybe we should just get the definition on the table. What do you mean?
That's a very good question, actually. There's a raging debate in academia about what the boundaries of this are. I really talk about people who have private ownership in their business and have control and run that business. So I do include family businesses, even if it's second or third generation, if they are the ones who own it and control it and take on the risk, and it also includes startups.
Okay, and do you think the entrepreneur is someone who is rightly called a risk taker, or is it someone who is just a businessman who's starting on his own?
I think we see both. I think those who are intentional about becoming entrepreneurs are willing to take on risk. I don't see them as reckless risk takers, at least not the successful ones. I look at my own career as an entrepreneur, and while we took on risks, they were always very calculated, very thought through, very well researched and analyzed, and more kind of a prudent risk-taking. In today's economy, we are seeing a lot of what I call accidental entrepreneurs, people who had never intended to own their own business, but because the economy has been in such a dire strait for the last 5 years, and especially some of the older folks who aren't ready to retire and yet aren't as readily employable being older, are finding themselves with no choice but to try and do something on their own.
We are talking with Dr. Jeff Cornwall, who's a professor of entrepreneurship at Belmont University in Tennessee. He's also published 8 books on entrepreneurship, and he writes a blog called The Entrepreneurial Mind, which is part of Forbes Blog Network. In fact, it was named as Best of the Web. So Jeff has been talking to us sort of about the personality of entrepreneurs. So my question now is to follow up a little more practically. If someone wants to leave the traditional work world and move into the world of entrepreneurial startups, what would be the first step to take?
Well, there's a couple things. I think one of the things that I would encourage them to do is to really understand what that means in terms of their work and their job. I see a lot of people leaving corporate world are quite frankly kind of shocked about what it means to be a business owner. They're used to having systems, they're used to having people take care of things, they're used to having IT people and cleaning staff and clerical staff and accounting staff, and all of a sudden all of that becomes them. And so I think I always have a long conversation with people leaving the corporate world with a real reality check about what the job description really is. And it's everything. It's everything and anything that needs to go on in the business for quite a while.
Well, isn't one of the things that you would teach an entrepreneur is the importance of not doing everything and the importance of delegating as much as possible so that he can focus on just what his core business is?
Well, yes and no. There's the whole matter of what you can afford. And so in the very early stages, especially if you're a fairly lean startup in terms of finances, while that is all well and good to focus on what you know best, you may not have the resources to either outsource or hire the kind of people that can do those kinds of activities. And so early on, for the survival of the business and its cash flow, you may be doing some things that are a stretch for you in terms of your own experience.
Chief cook and bottle washer. So you're saying it's not one of the biggest,
you know, there's a Guy Kawasaki, who's a famous entrepreneur here in the States. One of his favorite sayings, and I think he's quoting somebody else, is, the leading cause of death of startups is running out of cash. And I think one of the reasons that a lot of, especially people who come out of the corporate world, run out of cash so quickly in their startups is they burden them with a lot of overhead that the business just can't support. They create infrastructure that the revenues of that business just aren't ready to support yet. Now they will be, but the key thing you want to try to do is get that revenue flowing quickly and getting to cash flow positive as quickly as possible, and then you can start to add on some of the infrastructure that you need to support the business as it grows.
So that's the kind of risk also that an investor might have to really look at when he's looking at a small startup coming to him to raise money, angel capital.
Right.
Personally, as my day job is that I'm an investment advisor. I only do the radio gig once a week. But people come to me all the time with ideas, and I get business plans on my desk all the time. This is certainly not a solicitation for any more because I don't actually deal with that kind of business. But one of the things I've seen is they're always putting in a big salary for themselves at the beginning. They want the angel investors to be paying these founders to start. And I'm thinking, no one's going to want to pay for that. You have to show some proof of concept first.
You know, yes, absolutely true. And there's a fine line there because – first of all, an angel investor should never invest in an idea. They should invest in the person. And there's a saying in the venture capital community that, that we bet on jockeys, not horses. And so, that's the first thing as an investor, as an angel investor, especially a first time one, I would say is don't get all wrapped up in ideas. Look at the people, look at their ability to execute. Business failure doesn't happen because of bad ideas as much as it does because of bad management. And so look for people who can manage it and do it well. While you want people to have some skin in the game and maybe not pay themselves big salaries, you also don't want them to get to the point where they're hurting so badly personally that they might walk away from the deal. And so for an investor, you want to make sure that there's enough cash flow so that the entrepreneur can at least, you know, keep a roof over their head and keep food on their table, not get rich, not enrich themselves on your money, but at least get paid enough to kind of hang in there with the long run.
So I guess one of the other big issues that small companies have is the fact that depending what industry you're in, there might be some government regulation or huge amounts of government regulation. And a lot of times, in fact, as a small businessman myself, I run an independent investment advisory company. We've got a few people on staff, but we're not a major international player. The government regulations seem designed to oversee, you know, the big banks and the brokerage firms that have 25,000 employees, but we still have to deal with all of that. And a lot of people feel that the governments, you know, do this on whatever country you're in, they do this on purpose to try to drive the small guys out of business. How can people handle that when they are small businesses?
Yeah, and you're right. That is a global problem. I teach international entrepreneurship, and when we look at the entrepreneurial experience literally around the globe, one of the big impediments is regulation. And I don't think they do it intentionally. You know, maybe there's some lobbying going on by the big corporations to kind of make it difficult for startups. But I think a lot of it is they're just trying to deal with problems in an industry or perceived problems in an industry, and they just pass laws kind of looking at the big corporations that have caused this, not understanding the undue burden on a small business. There's been studies here in the States that show the cost of regulation per employee tends to be double what it is for a big corporation. So the burden is huge. Mm-hmm. What can a small business owner do? It's a real dilemma, and I think it's keeping entrepreneurs out of certain industries, and it's kind of sad that they're not able to do that. I think the best you can do is understand that going in, recognize what those costs are going to be, and make sure that your business model can support those costs.
Wow. All right. That was not the optimistic answer that I was
hoping. Yeah, I know. It's tough. The big barriers are regulation and taxation, and both of those are pretty tough globally right now. What's interesting is, you know, I just got back from Eastern Europe with a group of students, and over in you know, the former communist world, they're running as fast as they can to try and deregulate the environment for small businesses to try and encourage it more. And it's working. You know, you're seeing entrepreneurial startups flourishing in Estonia and Lithuania and Poland. And yet it seems that in the more developed world, we're kind of backtracking and actually re-regulating and in many ways re-regulating in ways that put a huge burden on small businesses.
And I think the irony of this is that certainly in the States, small businesses are the major employer. And
if you look at the last 20 years, the stats are about 78% of all new jobs have been created by companies under 200 employees. And up until the 2008 crash, the small businesses accounted for over half of all employees. And I'm talking small companies under 200, not 500 or 1,000 employee kind of companies, really, truly smaller businesses. And we're doing nothing right now in the States to help them. And it's a big frustration for those of us over here trying to figure this out for folks. And I don't see a change anytime soon, which is kind of discouraging.
Man, okay. We have been having a somewhat discouraging conversation with Dr. Jeff Cornwall. You can follow up with his writing and his ideas and his very popular blog called The Entrepreneurial Mind, which is part of the Forbes blog network. Jeff, it's been fascinating, but we're just about out of time. In the last few seconds, tell me, how can people follow your work?
My blog is it can be found at Dr. Jeff Cornwall, drjeffcornwall.com. And I also am very active on Twitter, and that's Cornwall J is my handle, and I make pretty regular posts at both sites, so I'd love to have people join in the conversation.
Okay, and we'll put links to those on the show notes at goldsteinongelt.com. Jeff, thanks so much for your time.
I appreciate it, Doug, and enjoy talking with you.
You've been listening to the Goldstein on Gelt show with money maven Doug Goldstein. Doug's weekly radio show is heard around the world, but if you miss it, you can download the podcast at www.goldsteinongelt.com. The Goldstein on Gelt show gives you up-to-date financial ideas so you can get on the path to financial freedom. If you'd like your questions answered on the air or off, send Doug an email to doug@profile-financial.com. It's your money for your future, so join Doug every week to build your wealth on the Goldstein on Gelt show.